Last week, Carol gave us an excellent theological framework for our Rumic sale. The transformation of God's creation, good and beautiful, yet deeply flawed and in need of repair. Our ability to connect and share with others, even giving away our possessions and our money to help the needy and forgotten ones, is part of this repairing process. Carol's insight was helpful to us to see our awareness of God's blessing and having more than we need, and an ability to give away our possessions, even things that we might have emotional connection to, attachment to, and that this itself is a deeply spiritual exercise of training the heart with a tangible result. We feel better if we share what we have with others. The seat of that emotion in Semitic culture is the heart. And today in Luke's Gospel, Jesus goes even a little further in peeling more of the onion for us, trying to get to the core of what it means to be a human being, working on our own self-repair and the repair of God's world. Both in Judaism and in Christianity, this commandment is not optional. The Ten Commandments root us in connection to family, elders, ancestors, the community, and neighbor. And in being connected, we are loving and honoring God. That includes the loving of self, taking time to renew and restore oneself and those under our care. Our families, perhaps our employees, observing Sabbath. And Sabbath was not only about enjoying time off from work and the hard labors of everyday life, but Sabbath is about a foretaste of heaven, when everyone and everything shares in the wholeness and the love of God. Sabbath rest was not only about observing religious rituals, but it was a window into eternity when both slave and rich man, women and men, cattle and all living things shared equally in rest and renewal. I think very differently these days about Sabbath. You know, so often in the church, we think about Sabbath as observance. You have to go to church on the Sabbath. But if we look at what the Bible talks about when they talk about Sabbath, it is much, much more than that. At its heart, it was a foretaste of creation perfected, with justice and equality, a time to celebrate that with family and friends, to feast and to remember our blessing in creation. Just as God rests on the seventh day, so all of God's creation needed rest and time for renewal. And I wonder what that old biblical concept might mean for us in the 21st century. How might Sabbath kind of get a facelift in our modern day? And I think about how important it is in our those intimate relationships of our spouses, right? It's really important. Sometimes we're just too busy. The kids take up all our time. It's important to take time with that person we fell in love with and spend time with them and renew that relationship. That's a kind of Sabbath. And how we take time with family, and especially the ones who are maybe we're most distant from, physically and emotionally, Sabbath time from our work. Maybe a day without emails and connecting on the internet is a kind of Sabbath. A way to have eye-to-eye relationships instead of cyber communications. Maybe a personal retreat, a day or two to regroup and renew. Sabbath for the people who work for you, your employees, that they have time to renew and to do this for themselves. And rummage is a kind of manifestation of a Sabbath on possessions and things that clutter our lives and priorities. Others may need them more than we do. So act as a channel of things and treasure that will bless others. Last week's gospel, we heard about the reality of the rich fool who planned for an easy retirement by building bigger barns and putting his trust in the market and others who need to buy and consume his goods. And we know how that story ended. This morning's word of advice from Jesus builds upon the theme of blessing, abundance, and gifts given by God, and how we train our hearts in the direction of the kingdom of justice and equality, of Sabbath rest and renewal of ourselves in the earth. We are liberated from the constant preoccupations of having to make a living, of being dominated and controlled by another, by the state, by society, what is expected from us. This is Sabbath rest. A kingdom where there is enough for everyone, like the many banquets Jesus describes in his teaching about the kingdom, where the marginalized and the alien have an equal place at the table as those who simply assume that our place is guaranteed. Jesus goes further and warns those of us who may feel a little closer to God or a little better than the rest, that we need to be careful, and we also need to be prepared for the shock of what the kingdom will mean. It's certainly not about business as usual. It comes like a thief breaking in the night in our very secure world and homes, all locked up and safe and secure, like the rich fool's barns from last week's story. Today's readings, particularly the Gospel and the Old Testament reading, presents us with this tension about the connection between what is broken and imperfect and what is the promise. Beautiful readings today connects those, and what that might mean for our modern age. And the opening sentence in the Gospel is an affirmation of that ancient Jewish belief and commitment. Fear not, little flock. It is the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. And Jesus is speaking to his little community. It's a minority community, little flock, like a shepherd. We are not the majority. There is something about human nature that places the blessed and those who get the bigger picture always in the minority. The Jewish people have always been a minority, have always had to deal with the tyranny of the majority. The shepherd, at the time of Jesus, was code for the political leaders. And if we think about, you know, Jesus the good shepherd, and it's all kind of cute. But when Jesus is talking about the shepherd, he's talking about political leaders, like David. David was the shepherd king. And when he talks about the shepherds of Israel, he's talking about the leaders of his country. And he's kind of given up on them because they've sold out. They're not doing what they should be doing. He weeps and laments over his people because they're like sheep without a shepherd. They don't have any political leadership. How does that speak to us today? We are minorities. We are dealing our values as from that Jewish Christian tradition. We have to somehow be able to cope with what we see going on around us. And so that word, fear not, little flock, it's the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom, is profoundly inspirational at a time like this. He is lamenting over the cowardly, self-serving leadership that has capitulated to the values of the Roman Empire in his day. Instead of a kingdom of justice and peace and equality, the Pax Romana was a heavy price to pay. It was peace through military occupation. It was peace through forced heavy taxation and state-sponsored terror through crucifixion. Crucifixion was the political price to pay if you stepped out of line. It was a kind of form of state terrorism. So the Pax Romana was a sham. It was peace and Roman justice through coercion and violence war and control of the masses. And this is not the kingdom that Jesus is talking about. We are promised by God that one day there will be peace, prosperity, and justice on the earth, and that God's justice and God's love will live in every human heart, trained in the way of Sabbath rest and Sabbath restoration. Sabbath is a foretaste of that heavenly kingdom. And Jesus talks about these kingdom moments that break in and these two worlds collide, right? And when you give someone a glass of water or a coat, it's a kingdom moment that breaks in. Or we are like the Good Samaritan, we respond to someone in need, it's a kingdom moment that breaks in. The Celtic Irish tradition has another image for this kingdom. We call it thin spaces, where the space between heaven and earth becomes thinner. And we have these places, sometimes they're physical places, where heaven and earth are one, or in relationships, heaven and earth are one. That's a kingdom moment. And the process of full restoration is promised by the training of the heart. And this is the key principle as to how and when we get there as a human race. We see this principle in one family in the Old Testament reading, Sarah and Abraham. And you know, today's reading is funny because maybe 30 years ago, God has promised Abraham and Sarah a child together. So there's a kind of cynical conversation going on between Abraham and God. Oh, by the way, you forgot about, what about that promise that I was going to have an heir, God? You know, how long, Lord? How long, Lord? And God promises, and it does come about, but it doesn't come about in the time. And it's interesting, Abraham is very successful. He's a very successful business leader. He is kind of morally dubious. There are times in Abraham's life when he hasn't made the right decisions. Remember that story when they're in exile in Egypt and they may be in danger, but he lets Pharaoh have sex with his wife. He said, oh, she's my sister. It's okay if you want her. So it's interesting that this kind of morally dubious character, sometimes he makes good decisions, sometimes he doesn't, that he's in this relationship with God, who is promising something that he's almost giving up on what God has promised him. And yet we know that that promise does come through, and that journey of faith, difficult as it is, the kingdom seems so far, but yet it comes through, right? Maybe not in our time. And the epistle is all about that. There is that the people who promise, they don't often see it, but they trust that something else, something bigger, is at work within us. So these stories for me in the modern day are really important because they help me deal with the world as I see it. And I march to a different drum because of these stories. It helps me deal with the craziness that I see going on in this country. And it's on our hearts, to see what that's doing for things like gun violence. And I've written about that in Athens this week. The statistics are crazy. Why is it that we have 50 million homes in America where we have an average of 8 guns per house? We are the gun-toting capital of the world. Fear not, little flock. I remember talking to one of our counselors in the community, and I asked her, I said, so what's going on for people these days? What are you hearing when you're listening to people? They're coming to see you. She said, anxiety. People are just anxious about everything. Right? Fear not, little flock, Jesus is saying to us. And how do we connect with the reality today and that Sabbath rest that is promised for us? And I think it's the secret is in the training of the heart. The training of the heart. Jesus talks about Look where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. So in training our heart to be open to kingdom moments, we learn to live with things that are broken and need of repair and need attention, but we start paying attention to it. I remember being aware, you know, it's actually coming from Ireland, we don't tip when we go out to dinner. It's just not part of our culture. And I was very interested in America that when you go to a restaurant, it's the custom to tip. And then I realized that there are a lot of people, that this, the wages in restaurants are so low that people depend on tipping, right? And there's so many more people. And when you're generous in tipping, you become aware of those wait staff. You become aware of their lives. And so many people depend on tips to live, right? So the heart is trained that where you're putting your treasure, where you're writing your checks, your heart is paying attention. A different kind of end of the scale, a friend of mine recently bought a very expensive Jeep, a Wrangler, one of those very nice little Jeeps. And he bought this Jeep and he noticed as he was driving around, other people driving Jeeps would wave at him. So there's a kind of code, if you have a Jeep, you all wave at each other. It's a kind of club. And again, it's like you're not aware of something until you've made that commitment, until you're on that journey. So Jesus is talking about how do we train our hearts? And in a way, the rummage sale, back to Carol's story last week, is about the training of the heart, of becoming aware and letting go of the stuff that we don't need anymore. We're becoming aware of who are the people who are using that, who are needing that. And our hearts go in a different direction. So often training the heart can lead us in a direction that we may not be aware of. Fear not, little flock. So I was looking at this week, I was researching because of all this gun control stuff. I said, what's the Episcopal Church doing about that? Part of the anxiety that we're living in today is people are so afraid that they're arming themselves to the teeth. I don't think that's a solution, right? And I look at the shepherds of Israel, the leaders, the political leaders of Israel. What about the shepherds of America? What's our leadership up to? Why can't we fix this problem? And I said, what's the Episcopal Church doing about this? So I went on the internet and I dug deep and I found out a couple of things that there were a number of significant resolutions that our national church passed about gun control. Things like permits to carry concealed weapons and criminal background checks for every gun purchase, except for the use of military and law enforcement agencies to ban the sale, the transfer, the importation, and manufacture of military-style assault weapons and high-capacity magazines, to tighten laws against gun trafficking and increase penalties for those who engage in straw purchases of firearms, and prohibit persons from purchasing guns without evidence of gun safety training, as well as promoting funding for research in the prevention and causes of gun violence. So our national church, this is very much on our radar. But I said, well, what are we doing about it today? And then I found out that we have a coalition of bishops against gun violence. And this was started after San Diego. And we have 80 bishops that are part of that coalition. And you know, we have about 200 bishops, and I wonder what the rest are doing. But at least we have 80 bishops, a minority again, standing up, trying to do something about this. And there's also a Facebook page. There's about 10,000 people who share in that Facebook page called Episcopalians Against Gun Violence. So we're trying to do something. And last week it was great to see the Bishop of Washington, Marianne Buddy, standing outside the offices of Mitch McConnell with other faith leaders, representing those of us who that our hearts are broken. How do we train our hearts to go in a different direction? We have to put our time, our effort, and our treasure so that we can follow our hearts into that Sabbath rest, into that healing of justice and equality. So these stories that we read today, for me, are very helpful. They're helpful. They help me understand that the kingdom is promised. And that in training my heart and in training our hearts, we're going to get there. We're going to get to that place that Jesus is promising. And in the meantime, we're not to be afraid. We're not to be afraid. My religion teaches me great patience through stories like today. But it also teaches me to train my heart to respond to the things that I may not see very clearly unless I begin to give it my time, my attention, and my treasure. Fear not,